Gathered in this room on this Sunday as a personification of the unmerited favor of God. That's what grace means. It is a gift that He has given without there being any expectation on His part of there being a return on the investment. And when I look at you, and I don't know everybody's story, but I know enough stories that are in this house to know that there is just an abundance of amazing grace that's represented here. As a matter of fact, why don't you just look around for a minute and think about some other folks' story and just think about how surprised you are that they're in church on a Sunday morning. That's amazing. Hallelujah. A lot of us ought to have amazing grace stamped on our forehead. We got the t-shirt and the sweatshirt and everything else because the unmerited favor of God has been ours and we have laid hold to it. And I'm so glad for the goodness of God, aren't you? Hallelujah. Why don't we lift our voices with a shout of appreciation right now for the grace of God, for the amazing grace and goodness of God that's been extended toward us. Ah, yes, 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 yes. I will bless you, O God. I will praise you with my whole heart. I will exalt you and I will acclaim and I will declare your worthiness. Hallelujah. And I know that when we think about amazing grace, the best thing to think about is the fact that you and I are saved. But I have to confess that when I walk in here on this Sunday morning, I find a whole lot amazing. Hallelujah. It's pretty neat. Amazing. Amazing. You can be seated. All this stuff, I can hear myself up here. Hallelujah. We've got blue pews. Everybody needs blue pews. Amazing. Amazing. Got a baptistry. That last place we was in didn't have any baptistry. Gymnasium. Got warm water. We probably, if we don't have anybody who wants to be baptized, somebody ought to just volunteer to let Brother Butler and I practice. Amazing. Man. And I tell you what else is amazing. You can swim in this thing. It's huge. It's huge. And so far, no, I will later when I baptize. Who was that said that? All right, we'll practice with you in a little while, and we can show them how deep it is. Hallelujah. And the carpet and the paint, and man, this is just amazing. What's in here? Wow! The fellowship hall, it's... It says you can have 125 people seated in here. Woo! There's a kitchen. The stuff works in it, too. Man. Here, what's the thing? Biscuit. It really ought to be. Amazing. Hey. Hey. And they put up all the basketballs. While I was wandering around here, I've never pastored a church, never been part of a church that had a gym. And just in here, there's two signs. One says women, and another says men. And for a year, we have not had any sign except restroom. And it was for everybody. Whoa, there's another. Two more signs. Restroom. Do you know what? I think somebody told me there's 9 restrooms in this thing. Whoa. Let me go upstairs. No, I ain't got to go upstairs. Super. Man, it's under construction. You youngsters are not going to believe this thing. You're just not going to believe it. And over this direction, there's a thing on this east side that's just empty. We're going to need a prayer room. Our tray is just right, having fellowship and hallelujah. This is something else. You talk about amazing. You talk about amazing grace. Yeah. Hallelujah. I think we ought to get it in gear on this Sunday. Hallelujah. And like I tell the praise team most Sundays, we need to hit it and get it. Hallelujah. Look what God has blessed us with. Don't anybody get to ignoring the favor and the blessings of the good God that we serve. Hallelujah. I will bless you, O Lord. I will praise you. And I will magnify your name forever.
Yeah. Holy Spirit, rain down on us. Holy Spirit, rain down on us.
Holy Spirit, rain.
Holy Spirit,
such a great thing to see this beautiful audience on this kind of cold, rainy Sunday morning when the coronavirus remains in epidemic proportion. And here we are. It's good to see guests, longtime friends. Glad you're here. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. If you're our guest today and you'd be interested in what is known as a home Bible study, they really are just personal Bible studies. They may happen in a cafe or an office, coffee shop, or home. If you'll see one of our hostess or hosts after church, they'll be glad to connect you with someone who can teach a home Bible study. Bless you. You can be seated. When you walked in, you were given one of these. Is there anybody in the house that does not have this little gizmo here? Okay, several hands are up. Keep those hands up where that you can be served. This is important. Just before his crucifixion, Jesus gave his disciples something to do. Many, if not all of you, are learned enough in the scripture to know about the Last Supper. It would be his last meal with them before he would be put to death. It was also a Jewish feast. And at that event, there were several components to it, and it always involved unleavened bread and a number of cups of wine. And Jesus took some of that unleavened bread and he broke it and gave it to them and said, "Take, eat, this is my body." And so they ate that unleavened bread and he took what is known as the third cup of the Passover and he poured it for them and he said, "And drink, and this is my body. This is my blood, excuse me, that is shed for the remission of sins, for the washing away, for the removing, for the eliminating of the stain of sin." And then Jesus said to that group of men, "Do this in remembrance of me." I want you to think about the fellows that were in that deal that day, 12 of them. Within hours, 10 of them would have totally forsaken him. One of them would have stood in front of a fire, and he would have denied ever knowing Jesus. And then one of them went down to the Jewish authorities, and he sold his friend Jesus to eventually be crucified for the price of a slave. That's the guys Jesus asked to do this in remembrance of him. Don't you have an idea that he knew who they were? Knew what he was dealing with? And yet, to these people who would become such failures in so many ways, at least for the next while, the Lord intentionally included them. You know, I'm glad he did, because I can relate to that. If it only included the angelic, then I would have been excluded. If it would have only been for those who were perfect and had no inadequacies, none of us would be included. But he got with 12 men who were not really well put together. He said, "And I want you to eat this. It's a memorial of my body, and I want you to drink this. It's a memorial of my blood. And matter of fact, you're to do this until I come." Now, the meal that Jesus and his friends were having was part of a Jewish feast. It was called the Feast of the Passover. And Numbers chapter 9 talks about the Passover. And I'm going to need you to help me with reading here a little bit. I'm going to read the first three verses, and then we're going to move down to verse number 6, and I want you to help me engage with the Bible by reading alternate verses. "And the Lord spake unto Moses in the wilderness of Sinai in the first month of the second year after they were come out of the land of Egypt, saying, Let the children of Israel also keep the Passover at his appointed season. And the 14th day of this month at even you shall keep it in his appointed season. According to all the rites of it and according to all the ceremonies thereof shall you keep it. And now let's move down to verse 6. And there were certain men who were defiled. Everybody say defiled. Look at somebody beside you and say, you look defiled to me. To be defiled put certain limits on what a Jew could participate in. And the word means to be stained or to be tainted in some way. So in the Jewish application of this, it meant that you had a stained or tainted soul, and you were excluded from being involved in certain things. And one of those was the Passover. And it wasn't just that these defiled were excluded, but there was what was called an overshadowing of defilement. And so if I had touched someone who was dead, if I came in contact with my wife or children or any of you, you were rendered unclean by having come in contact with me, because I was defiled. And so it was a serious thing. And they said, we have been defiled by the dead body of a man, and we can't keep the Passover. And they came before Moses and before Aaron on that Passover morning. And the men said to him, we are defiled by the dead body of a man, wherefore we are kept back. We are restrained or withheld, that we cannot offer an offering of the Lord in his appointed season. And they make it a question, are we? And Moses basically says, I don't know. Give me a minute. Let me talk to the Lord. And so he makes this request, and the Lord spoke to Moses and said to him, speak to the children of Israel, saying, if any man of you or of your posterity, any of your descendants, shall be unclean by reason of a dead body, or be in a journey afar off, yet he shall keep the Passover unto the Lord. God not only addressed their question, he also addressed something that would not even be an issue for the next 40 years. That was someone being on a journey, taking care of business away from home at Passover time. But on the 14th day, this was the 14th day of the first month, but the Lord said, on the 14th day of the second month at even, they shall keep it, and they shall eat it with unleavened bread and bitter herbs. 1 month after the normal Passover, there was a second Passover, that none would be excluded by defilement or by being at a distance from their family and from the house of God. Let me give you some perspective on what all of this was about. Passover happened because there was a nation that the Lord had entered into a covenant, a relationship with. The nation was called Israel. And they ended up in bondage down in Egypt, and they would be there for centuries, actually. And they became slaves in Egypt, and finally they began to pray to God, saying, we're tired of the harshness of our lives, and would you please help us? And God heard them, and he sent a deliverer to them. And the Lord, he tried to get them out, and Pharaoh said, no, I like having cheap labor. And so he wouldn't let them go. And so the Lord decided the only thing that's ever going to make this work is if the firstborn of every family in Egypt dies. Well, the Israelites lived in Egypt too. But the Lord also said to them, if you will take the blood of an unblemished lamb, and if you'll put some of that blood up on the top of your door, and if you'll put it on the doorpost, when death visits Egypt and comes to every household and the firstborn of every house dies, you will be excluded, and I will pass over you. And so the day appointed came, and it was just as the Lord said, every house that had the blood on the top and on the doorpost, he passed over. And the Lord also said to them, this is to be a memorial for you. This is something that you are to perpetually celebrate. And they called it actually the Feast of Freedom. When I see the blood, I will pass over you. And God did what he said, just like he always does. If you're waiting on a promise from God to go bad, you're going to have a long wait, because his promises are yea and amen. It wasn't a sad occasion. Sometimes we turn communion into something that's just kind of moaning and groaning, and we can make it so difficult. Passover wasn't that. Passover was a joyous celebration. It was that we used to be in bondage, but we have been set free. Our neighbors had death visit their house, but it didn't come to our house. God did what he said he would do. We have the blood on the doorpost, and we have the lamb on the inside. And guess what? The Lord protected us, and the Lord came through, and they kept their festival of freedom moving forward. Here they are on this first time that they're going to celebrate it. And they come that morning. These guys wake up, and it suddenly dawns on them. This is a big deal that's happening today. This is something to be joyous about. And it wasn't just that each person did it, but instead it was done by families. And the father of a household led his family in this celebration of the Passover. And so if dad couldn't participate, the family really couldn't fully participate either. And so there they were. They were left out. They were excluded on that day. And that's the reason. That morning they came to Moses and to Aaron and said, "Hey, wait a minute. Hey, wait a minute. We're being left out of something that matters a lot. We have been defiled. We are excluded." And Moses said, "If you'll just give God's grace a little time, if you'll just give him 30 days, you're going to have another shot at being included." Hallelujah. Some of you, you're thinking right now, "But Pastor, I don't belong in any service where we even talk about the Lord's Supper." But you need to hear me today. There is a second movement of grace that comes to your life. You may have lived your life defiled and excluded, and you may feel like you deserve nothing. You deserve nothing of the favor of God. You have nothing to remember. But the fact that you're sitting in this house on a Sunday morning, hallelujah, has a praise team is talking about the goodness of the Lord. And as we're singing Amazing Grace, let me tell you something. That means that you have a festival to celebrate of your very own today. Hallelujah. And for you saints of God, listen to me. You have been liberated. Free at last. Free at last. Thank God Almighty, I'm free at last. Hallelujah. You have a promise of life, and that being more abundant. Hallelujah. So defiled by a bad past. Or maybe you've traveled a long distance away and you've not been where you could have been to participate in the Feast of Freedom. On this Sunday, let's just act like it's a month later. And let's include the excluded. And let's allow participation of some that I've been defiled by death, and I've been defiled by uncleanness, and I don't have any right for any. Please don't miss out on the joy of the goodness of God. Don't let any hindrance keep your children from seeing the goodness of God in your life. And so right now I want you to take that packet, and I want you to open. And I want you to get that bread out of the top of it. And there are little tricks to it. I don't really have the magic approach. But I want you to take that little wafer. I want you to look at it. If anybody needs pliers, we've got some up here. I want you to take that wafer, and I want you to look at it. Jesus took bread just a whole lot like that. And this was what those men who had been defiled by body, this was what they were wanting to eat. This was what they felt left out of, was this Passover. Time of unleavened bread. Take, eat, this is my body which is broken for you. And today we celebrate that we have been delivered, we have been redeemed, we have been set free, we have been saved by Calvary and the shed blood of Jesus Christ. And I want you to take that bread and take, eat. This is my body, and I want you to celebrate it as a Passover just now. And I want you to take that cup. And Jesus said, you take this cup and this is my blood that's shed for the washing away and the dealing with the shame and the guilt of your sin. Do this to remember me. The blood will never lose its power. Preacher, I'm a bad sinner. The blood of Jesus has never found any sin that it couldn't deal with. Preacher, I'm an addict. Preacher, I've done this, I've done that. Hallelujah. His blood, Calvary, take that cup and this do. Remembering him and remembering that he passes us over because of this salvation. And so on this Sunday morning, last thing Jesus did before his crucifixion, and one of the first things that the early church began, because they continued steadfastly in the apostles' doctrine and the breaking of bread, one of the first things that the 12 taught them was about this thing called communion. As we come into this new space for Calvary, hallelujah, I think it's an appropriate thing that we begin just like this, celebrating, hallelujah, what it is that Jesus has done for us. Why don't we stand to our feet, and without a sound coming from up here, I want you to throw your hands up, and I want us to make this a celebration right now of the fact that he has saved us, he has delivered us, he has kept us. Come on. Oh, yeah. That's it. I have been saved. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I have received. I have benefited. I have the goodness of God in my life. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. I could be excluded, but I'm not excluded. I have been included by a further stretch of grace. Oh, yeah. Glory, 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 glory.
The blood that Jesus shed.
Your time. From day to day. there are needs that are here. And I want us to do as we do on occasion and recognize the pandemic limitations, and we need to respect and give distance and all of that. But I want you to find two or three people close to you that you feel comfortable with this. And it's just one, that's fine too. I want you to share a need with them right now. And I want you to believe that God is going to help. But just move around a little bit. And of course, again, as I said, let's respect our social distancing. And you may have to holler your need to each other. But some you might not want to shout too loud. But would you do that right now? And, you know, this does require a little bit of movement. I'm not seeing much movement. Hallelujah. I feel like something good's about to happen. I prayed for the supernatural. We've been asking God for the operation of the gifts of the Spirit. For the supernatural. Come on. Anybody have that kind of faith here today? Anybody have that kind of expectation? Hallelujah. Has he ever healed you? Has he ever answered a prayer? Have you ever exercised your faith and God did an amazing thing for you? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. In the name of Jesus, I pray a release of the Holy Ghost across this room. What we prayed for earlier, God, I ask, Lord, that it become a reality just now. God, let there be the rain of your presence. Let there be the outpouring of your glory in this room. In the name of Jesus, our needs, our situations, our circumstances. God, there's financial needs. God, there are circumstances, God, that need your intervention. God, I pray for my friends today. They mean much to me. Jesus, 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 you include, oh God. You're the inclusive Savior. Hallelujah. God, that second extension of grace, that second extension of Passover. God, in the name of Jesus, in the name of Jesus, in the name of Jesus, in the name. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. That's it. I see something happening in the room just now. Oh, glory to God. 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 Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Abba, shabaha. Hallelujah. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord.
Lord, he endureth forever.
bless the Lord. I will bless the Lord at all times. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord.
With me, how great is our hallelujah, hallelujah. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. How great you are, Jesus. Hallelujah, hallelujah. How great you are, Savior. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. I feel the presence of the Lord in this house. Hallelujah. Oh, he's so wonderful today. The presence of the Lord is in this place. Hallelujah. I wish I had a voice. I would sing that. I don't have a voice, so hit a C. Surely the presence of the Lord is in this place.
I can feel his mighty power and his grace.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. I'm excited about what God is doing. When I look around this edifice today, I'm so thankful. Isn't God good to us? Praise the Lord. A house of worship. Hallelujah. We're here for the inaugural service, and I know we're going to be dedicating it here in a couple, 3 months, but today could just be a dedicatorial service where we just allow God to have his way, to move in any way he chooses and sees fit. Praise the Lord. You can be seated. Good to see everyone here. And I won't be long today. I don't have a whole lot of voice, but we want God to have his way. Hallelujah. Of course, again, we're meeting here for the first time in our new church, and it is a wonderful, wonderful edifice unto the Lord. I think we all should be thankful for what God has done, what he's doing, and what he's going to do in our future. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. I'm so thankful today that he's allowed us to obtain this beautiful building. May it always be a place of worship and praise unto the Lord Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. Many of you have known that I've went through and my family's went through a period of extended illness with the COVID-19. Had a lot of time to sit around and think and ponder on some things. And it seems like a theme. Brother Kuhn kind of asked me the other day about a theme going through my mind and what's the Lord been talking to me about. And one thing it seems like the Lord was impressing upon my mind, especially since we're moving into a new church, maybe new beginnings, a new purpose, a new outlook, praise the Lord. I begin to think about all this, our new church, our new beginnings, our new purpose, revival, things the Lord wants to do among us. And I begin to think in the Bible of another time where there was a new temple, a new time, a new purpose, a new covenant. This was at the building of the first temple, we know it as Solomon's Temple. And I begin to think upon the building and the majesty and the everything that went into building this first temple. for the Lord. This temple was completed in and around 960 BC. Jehovah God would have a place, a permanent home that would bear His name. For 400 years it had been a tabernacle that was moved around and temporary. But finally there would be a temple built with stone and with iron and with gold and everything that was there to be had that was fine in those days was used in the building of this temple. It must have been a wonderful sight to behold. There were cedar and fir trees from Lebanon. There was great and costly stones for the foundation of the building. The Bible teaches us that there was gold and silver and brass in abundance all throughout this temple. There was the brazen altar. There was the bronze laver or the molten sea. There were golden candlesticks in the holy place, and there were tables of showbread. And all of this was in splendor and majesty and wonder. And there was the most holy place with the two cherubims, with their wings touching and the Ark of the Covenant underneath. It must have been a wonderful place and a wonderful sight to behold. The Bible teaches us that 180,000 men worked on this project. One interesting fact that I find that was amazing to me, that at the site of the temple, there was no construction noise. There was no sawing. There was no chipping. There was nothing. They got everything prepared off-site, and they brought it to the Temple Mount and put it together. After 7 years, this great temple was completed. And it came time for the dedication of the great temple. The Bible says that Solomon built a scaffold, and he knelt down before the congregation and knelt down before God, and he began to pray a prayer. And this prayer was long, and I won't read the whole thing, but this prayer had one general theme. Lord, if Israel sins, if Israel falls, if Israel makes mistakes, if they prayed in this place, or if they prayed toward this place, would there be forgiveness if repentance was made? A couple of bullets from the prayer. If your people Israel are defeated before an enemy because they have sinned against you, and return to confess your name, hear from heaven and forgive the sin of your people. He went on to say, when the heavens are shut up and there is no rain because they have sinned against you, when they pray toward this place and confess your name and turn from their sin, forgive the sin of your servants. Another point he made, when there is famine, there is blight or disease, when each one spreads out his hands to this temple, then hear from heaven, your dwelling place, and forgive. When a Gentile prays, he even prayed for Gentiles. When a Gentile prays to the temple, would you hear from heaven and do according to all for which the foreigner asks you to do? Lord, when they sin against you and they repent, forgive your people who have sinned. Solomon, in all of his wisdom, begins to pray to an awesome, holy God. And he's asking this God, please allow forgiveness to always be available to your people. Always allow forgiveness to be available when we sin against you. Bible says in 2 Chronicles chapter 7 and verse 1. Now when Solomon had made an end of praying, the fire came down from heaven and consumed the burnt offering and the sacrifices, and the glory of the Lord filled the house. and the glory of the Lord filled the temple, filled the new house that Solomon had built. And the glory of God was so real that the priest could not enter the house. The new temple was filled with the glory and majesty of Almighty God. Lord, we have built you a new temple. Lord, we have built you a new dwelling place. Can we always count on you to forgive us when we fail? The Bible goes on to say in 2 Chronicles chapter 7 and verse 12, and the Lord appeared to Solomon by night and said unto him, I have heard thy prayer. I have heard thy prayer. And have chosen this place to myself for an house of sacrifice. If I shut up heaven and there be no rain, or if I command the locusts to devour the land, or if I send pestilence upon my people, if my people, which are called by my name, shall humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then will I hear from heaven and will forgive their sin and will heal their land. Now mine eyes shall be open and mine ears attend unto the prayer that is made in this place. Now have I chosen and sanctified this house, that my name may be there forever, and mine eyes and my heart shall be there perpetually. Solomon, don't you worry. If you fall, if Israel sins, if you make a mistake, if you'll run to me, hallelujah, if you will come to me, if you will humble yourself, if you will pray and seek my face and turn from your wicked ways, I will forgive. I will forgive. Don't you ever fear, Solomon. I will forgive. A new temple, a new beginning, and a new covenant. Humbleness, pray, seek the face of the Lord. Turn from wicked ways, and forgiveness will be extended. The temple of stone was not to last forever. Solomon's temple, which we have discussed at length, was destroyed somewhere around 587 B.C. by Nebuchadnezzar. You see, it was not God's intention to always dwell in rooms of stone, brass, and gold. In Jeremiah 31 and 31, the Bible reads, Behold, the days come, saith the Lord, that I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and with the house of Judah. Not according to the covenant that I made with their fathers in the day that I took them by the hand to bring them out of the land of Egypt, which my covenant they break, although I was an husband unto them, saith the Lord. But this shall be the covenant that I will make with the house of Israel. After those days, saith the Lord, I will put my law in their inward parts and write it in their hearts and will be their God, and they shall be my people. Hallelujah. Let me tell you something. God never intended to stay in walls of brick and mortar and stone, but man would become the temple of the Holy Ghost. Man would be the temple. Man would be the edifice that God lived in. In 1 Corinthians 6 and 19, the Bible says, What? Know ye not that your body is the temple of the Holy Ghost, which is in you? What? Know ye not that you were made to house the presence of God? Know ye not that you are the temple? Know ye not that you are the house of God? Each of you were created to be the temple of Almighty God. Hallelujah. We were created to house the Spirit of God. Hallelujah. Jesus died on a cross. Yeshua came to die on a cross that he could shed his blood and his body could be break. We commended that today when we celebrated the Passover and the blood and the breakage of his body. Because he was mutilated. Because he was sacrificed.
because he shed his blood on Calvary, we are able to house his presence, his deity, his greatness, his awesomeness. On the day of Pentecost, when they asked Peter, men and brethren, what shall we do? Peter said to them, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sins, and you shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. Remember, he said, if we would turn from wicked ways, humble ourselves, seek his... Let me tell you something. All we have to do is turn from a life of sin, turn from a lifestyle of wickedness, and begin to kneel at his feet in humbleness. God will forgive us if we'll repent. Repentance, and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sins. Just like Solomon's temple. Just like Solomon's temple that day when the glory and the majesty and the presence of God filled that temple. God will fill us full of his presence, his majesty, his forgiveness, his mercy. But Brother Buller, you don't know what I've done. It does not matter what you've done. I could care less what you've done. And you know what? Jesus cares less what you've done. He's ready to forgive it. He's ready to cover it and hide it with his blood. He's ready to fill the temple once again. He's ready to fill the temple once again. Hallelujah. But we let this day be a day of new beginnings. A day where the glory of the Lord fills the temple. One more time. I'm not talking about this room. Yes, I love this building. But this building is not the temple of God. I'm looking at a lot of temples out here. I'm looking at a lot of houses that God can fill. Why not allow this to be the day of new beginnings, a new purpose? Get involved with that new covenant with the Lord. Hallelujah. As the musicians come, I think we need to make this a day where saints and sinners alike make this a day of restoration, forgiveness, and putting the Lord where he belongs. In this temple. Everybody say, in this temple. Point to yourself and say, in this temple. Lord, I dedicate this temple to you today. Lord, we thank you for the beautiful building. We thank you, Lord, for everything you've blessed us with. But Lord, today we dedicate this temple. This temple. This temple to you, Lord. Hallelujah. As we stand all over the building. There's room up here if you want to come and stand around the altar areas. But come with a new purpose. Come saying, Lord, today's my day. I want the glory of God to fill this temple. Lord, I've lived for you a long time, but maybe, Lord, I fell back a little bit. But today, I'm catching up, Lord. Today, fill this temple again. Hallelujah. Let's dedicate this temple to the Lord. Hallelujah.
Given is this place a house of worship.
Jesus.
A place where we can meet in one accord. And our purpose is to give you praise and glory. We dedicate this temple to you, Lord. We dedicate this temple to you, Lord. Temple to you, Lord. a home for you, oh Lord. And our purpose is to give you praise and glory. I dedicate my life to living word.
Just circling the drain, so to speak. But you know what? This is the end of days. We're in the end of times. The Lord just impressed upon me to ask you this. Are you prepared? Are you ready for the end time revival? Are you ready for the end time roller coaster ride that the church is about to get on? He also asked me to ask you to dedicate yourself today. A new beginning, a new church, a new purpose, a new attitude. Get a bulldog grip on God. If you'll say, Jesus, I dedicate myself, this temple. Point to yourself. I dedicate this temple. I may have fallen back a little bit in 2020. I may haven't been what I needed to be up to now in 2020. But Lord, you can count on me from this point on. Because I'm dedicating this temple to your service. I'm dedicating my everything to your work. If you can do that. Lift those hands up and say, Lord, I dedicate this temple. I dedicate this temple to you. I dedicate myself.
I dedicate this temple to you, Lord. I dedicate this temple to you, Lord. Use it for your service. For a holy purpose, I dedicate this temple to you, Lord. We dedicate this temple to you, Lord.
Count on me, Jesus.
We dedicate this temple to you, Lord.
I'll be a witness for you, Lord. Hallelujah.
Use it for your service. For a holy purpose, we dedicate this temple to you, Lord.
Let's sing it one more time with our hands. Let's worship.
We dedicate this temple to you, Lord.
Hallelujah, hallelujah.
We dedicate this temple. dedicate this temple to you, Lord.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Oh, I feel the presence of the Lord. If we all show up for duty, 2021 is going to be a banner year for Calvary Pentecostal Church. I'm looking forward to having to bust out walls before long because we don't have room for everybody. And if you're a visitor here today, we want you to be a part of Calvary. Hallelujah. We want you to be a part of our church. We want your kids to be a part of our super church classroom, our youth class, our toddler class. Hallelujah. We want you to be a part of Calvary because Calvary is on the move and God is going to take us places. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. All right. If there's anything else, praise the Lord. Sister Ruth is going to come up with our announcements. Service times is going to be Wednesdays at 7 o'clock here. Thank God. I'm ready to start having some Wednesday night service. They tell me I look good on camera, but I think I look better in person. So Wednesdays at 7 o'clock, and no service this week because of Thanksgiving. But next Sunday, 9:45 prayer, 10:30 service. And yeah, okay.
Glasses here. No midweek service on Wednesday, the 25th. Prayer chain, November 29th. Sign up sheet at the front. Next Sunday, 9:45 prayer. 10:30 teaching, 11:15 socially distancing fellowship, 11:30 Sunday worship. Hope to see you all. And December 4th, Friday night, ladies' Christmas party at Calvary. Hallelujah. The cost is $15 and bring a dish and pay the $15 to Sister Shirley Powell. Sign up with Sister Powell what to bring, what you're going to bring. Super Church is tentatively scheduled to launch on December the 6th, 2 weeks from today. We'll update about other classes as known for plan in here. December 13th, Christmas at Calvary! Thank you, Jesus. Holiday schedule. No midweek service December 23rd or 30th. Church dedication May 21st to the 23rd. General Superintendent David K. Bernard. Hallelujah. We have a church. Thank you, Jesus.
Praise the Lord. I'm so thankful to have a place to call home. Thank God for the gym we were in. Pastor Coon was giving us his audio tour talking about all those restrooms. Can I get a witness? Yes. Praise the Lord. So thankful. So we're so thankful to have, and we want everybody to be a part of Calvary. So we'll see you next Sunday at 9:45. Last act of worship, give as unto God today. Praise the Lord. There's a sign-up sheet. Brother Daniel has a sign-up sheet for prayer chain next week. Let's pray and see God do some things. You're dismissed. Last act of worship, give as unto God.